Well, welcome all to our fourth edition of the Expat Cafe. It is for us today also a bit of an experiment again, because we do it for the first time in Zoom. So we'll see how this goes. But I'm very happy that you joined us this month as well. Today it will be all about health and healthcare. So after this plenary session, we have Dr. Nick Wen from the International Health Center Rotterdam telling us more about the Dutch healthcare system. And also, I can imagine you might have some questions about vaccination. So we can discuss that. But for now, in the beginning, we have Thomas as well from Portugal, who's our expert speaker of the month. Very glad to have him here. And for the ones who are here for the first time, the Expat Cafe came actually into life because, due to COVID, we've seen still expats traveling into Rotterdam. I'm Laura, working for the Rotterdam Expat Center, which is part of Rotterdam Partners. We are the actually promotion agency of the city. So we put Rotterdam internationally on the map. And as the Expat Center, we help internationals coming to the city, settle down here, but also to help them find their way. And the Expat Cafe was really meant to bring people together, to guide you, give you some tips, what you still can do in the city. And we always have an expat speaker. So today, Thomas will give some inspiration about how life as an expat was pre-COVID, but also how he has his days today. So I think we'll directly start with you, Thomas. Sure. So maybe just give us a short introduction about yourself.
Well, to put it bluntly then, my name is Thomas. Hi, everyone. I'm 22. Graduated last year from my study in Rotterdam. I did a bachelor in dance. Previous to that bachelor, I was living in Portugal. So yeah, that was the main reason as to why I came to the Netherlands. I've graduated, a year has passed, COVID is with us, and that's pretty much it in a nutshell.
And how was the step coming from Portugal to the Netherlands?
I mean, it was for sure a big change. Even more, I came to the Netherlands when I was 17. So couple more challenges there as well, even with legalities of just being able to go on the flight and things like that without my parents accompanying me, even to such minute details. But yeah, that aside, housing was the first major difficulty and struggle that I was confronted with, because yeah, that's a real challenge in Rotterdam, but managed to pull through, managed to get one, and then a better one, and even a better one. And
so yeah. You already moved to several times in Rotterdam, as I understand.
Yeah. Yeah,
okay.
I mean, for the first 6 months when I came to the Netherlands, I was living in Schiedam, because I didn't manage to find a place in Rotterdam. While being in Portugal, I couldn't come to the viewings. It was not particularly easy. Also not really being informed of the platforms that there were, but now I'm a bit more, so that also helps.
Yeah.
So, big complication. Finally, after 6 months of getting to know a bit more what's going on, getting to know Rotterdam, meeting people, making contacts, found a better home and managed to stay there for a while. And yeah, homes and homes after that.
Yeah, exactly. So if what was actually the breakthrough? So if I understand correctly, it was really about networking in order to find the right apartment, right?
Pretty much. I mean, because yeah, in Rotterdam, for the vast majority, you're either going to pay a lot or else you have to find the right chance. And most of them, especially networking with students or in that sort of setting, all of them are constantly moving in and out and aware of different properties. And a lot of the houses stayed often in the same university family or something like that. So, yeah, that's how I've been managing to find my way through thus
far.
Yeah.
Great. Well, for the ones next month, also the last Thursday of the month, we'll have, again, the Expat Cafe would focus also on housing. So interesting also to hear from housing agents how you can find still an apartment in these strange times. Good to tell. And welcome to all the new ones as well to the Expat Cafe. We are now with Thomas. He's from Portugal, talking about his experience here in Rotterdam. And maybe Thomas, what because you lived in several areas, right? So in Breda, in Schiedam, do you found like a difference? I hear somewhere a phone. Oh, yeah. What is the biggest difference maybe between the city you're in now and where you were before? Do you see like differences and what yeah.
Two different regions of the Netherlands to start off, being in Rotterdam or being in Breda, the whole Brabant region. And yeah, we did stereotypes and everything that I was fully unaware of, and then slowly but surely got a bit more acquainted with them as I lived a year in Breda. And yeah, it's, for starters, it was, for example, much easier for me to start learning a bit more Dutch, because they tend to speak more slowly and somewhat more articulate or something akin to that. So yeah, that made it easier to already finally start going at it a bit more, Dutch language knowledge. And yeah, it's a lot more nature. Rotterdam has a fair amount of nature and it's pretty good, but yeah, Breda and Biesbosch Natural Reserve and all of that was pretty good. It was one of the main things I did on my free time, just going biking through the forest and the regions.
Ah, nice. Yeah. And you're already telling about you're learning Dutch, I hear, right?
Trying, slowly but surely.
Trying. Yes. Do you feel like, because you're now here already 5 years, I think, right? Is it something that you would say like to new expats, learn from the start a bit Dutch, or is it good to start as soon as you feel like, well, I'm really staying here? Or what is your experience with the Dutch language and communicating with the others?
Yeah, I mean, well, each to their own, and you never know what's going to happen later on and forward. So as a general tip, just yeah, go for it if you're going to be here for a couple of years, because yeah, then it's done. If you need it, you need it. If you don't, you don't. But even in a cafe, when you meet a Dutch tourist, some, for whichever reason, just it's nicer and easier to have it. And on the long run, because also the first couple of years, I thought it was not necessary. And for the most part, it really wasn't. Also integrated with the expat community, a lot of internationals. So we speak English, simple as that,
yeah.
For everyone. But yeah, to be able to read your own blasting beans letters and CAK and whatever is coming your way, it's good to be able to get a clear insight.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's a valuable skill to have, and I appreciate it. And seeing that it's also a good way to busy up my time now, going for it.
Yeah, and for the ones who just arrived in the Netherlands, Thomas mentioned the Belastingdienst. It will be, it's a blue envelope. It's from the tax authorities, and the letters are always in Dutch. And one of the tips I would give, don't ignore the letter, please. Yeah, because often it's important letters. You will see an amount of money that you might need to pay. So if you have questions about us, please approach us, but just don't ignore it, because you can get a fine if you ignore it too long. So it's good that you mention it to Thomas. And that's why it's also very good to have some basic Dutch skills. So at least you can understand a bit. Maybe good to mention now already, there is an initiative in Rotterdam. It's called Walking and Talking. So if you already have some basic skills of Dutch language, you can go there and talk with others. And it's really about practicing the Dutch language. But I'll share more about it later on. Thomas, maybe what is your favorite spot in Rotterdam?
Yeah,
do you have one?
Not particularly one spot. There's too many of them in Rotterdam, and yeah, also depending on the conditions, you might find different spots more charming. But to give a blunt answer, Kralingen would be the favorite if there would be such a place. But yeah, I mean, also as I said before, it's a city that keeps on getting smaller and smaller, and you get more acquainted and different moods, different parts, different people. And Schiedam starts becoming also quite close to Rotterdam, and Vlaardingen is not too far. And slowly but surely you start mapping it out a little bit more and finding more areas of comfort within.
Yeah, that's true indeed. Rotterdam is, it's not just the city center. It's much more out there, and Vlaardingen and Schiedam you can reach very easy as well. And coming from Portugal, you must miss your products, your food, your culture. How do you adapt here in Rotterdam? Can you still find some pieces of Portugal?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there are a couple Portuguese cafes in Rotterdam and stuff like that. And there's even a Portuguese expat center in Matines or Single, if I recall it right. But anyway, it's a bit more than that. And of course, the weather, for example, is a big feature of the Netherlands. And quite different from Portugal, so that took some adapting to and moderating expectations. And last year we had a pretty good summer that helped substantially, and even this week with Koningsdag it was pretty good. So we enjoy them as they come and try to connect to home in different ways. And every couple months get a package from home with goodies, and yeah, connecting to what actually is home rather than the material stuff of it, I guess, was something that made it easier.
Oh, I see a question also from Sterling. What is your favorite Portuguese cafe?
There's no, they're already open again. I can send it. Yeah, I can send it also here on the chat.
Oh, great. Yeah, and also please feel free. Yeah, so if you have any questions for Thomas, just put them in the chat. So we have it an interactive session as well. Maybe one of the last questions for you, Thomas, on how, I mean, as said, we organize those sessions because we see that, especially for international, it's hard to get connected now in times of social distancing. How do you cope, and how do you still look for connections in these times? Because you said you were part of some international communities, right? Are they still active, or tell us more.
Yeah, I mean, once in a while, of course, connecting with friends and either the people you already know and new acquaintances, easy or hard as it may be right now to make newer ones. But yeah, to try and stay connected and aware of how people are doing also besides you, your friends around, rather than always connecting online. You can still be social distance with a mask and outside and whatever, but, you know, keeping up with each other and work. Weird as it may sound, is also, yeah, it's quite a social place. And if suddenly we've got to start calling people out by name and months pass and we start interacting a bit more and there is a bit more workplace dynamic, stuff like that also helps deal with these very different times and very different ways to socialize and connect in a physical and social context, yada, yada, yada.
Yeah, no, thank you for sharing these tips. Maybe one, yeah. It wasn't during our first expat cafe, and we had an expat from Brazil, and I loved her story because what she did, she said, well, I think she arrived just 2 months ago at that time. And what she said, well, I'm making friends at this moment at the supermarket because it's the only place where I can actually see people. And I thought it was not a too bad idea because you can still do it in a safe way. So yeah, it's still possible in these times to connect, and if you're still looking for communities, let us know, but I'll share some more. Well, thank you, Thomas, so much for being our expert speaker of the month. And if you all have any further questions for him, please send it in the chat, and I hope you enjoy Rotterdam still, and you stay in Rotterdam, you won't move away again in another region. Before we move on to the healthcare workshop, I would also like to share my presentation to give you still some tips as well on what to do now in times of we're living in. Let me see. Yeah, as said, I'm working for the Rotterdam Expat Center. For the ones who just joined, we are here for especially newcomers, but also expats are living here already for a while. We are here to help you. So we are here to guide you through the city, support you. If you have questions, especially now, I can also imagine you might have questions about the vaccination program, about the COVID rules. So please feel free to connect us. At the end of the slides, you'll get our contact details. But for now, especially what I would like to highlight a bit is, how can you still get in touch with people in Rotterdam, international, but also Dutch people? First of all, we have Venture Café, which we have today. Today, it's the Expat Café. It's every last Thursday of the month. Next month, we have it all about housing and how it works in the Netherlands. So either buy an apartment or to rent. But Venture Café is every Thursday, starting at 4 o'clock. It's digitally, as you could have seen when you entered. There is a lot of different topics you can discuss. And Cornelis will tell us later much more about Venture Café itself and how you can also use the social networking space, which is in Remo. But I'll save it Cornelis to explain. For the rest, I can really recommend to you, well, Sterling is also here. She's from International Women's Networking Group. She will be in the social space in a minute as well. And there you can get connected with her. I see that for today we have a lot of men. Usually it's a lot of women, so it's nice to see also men in this Expert Cafe. Also, Female Ventures will be present today. It's another female community where you can get connected. Well, I mentioned already walking and talking. As soon as everything is open again, there's also the Expat Cinema in Rotterdam. So usually here in Rotterdam or in the Netherlands, you have English movies with Dutch subtitles, but there you have then English movies or also from your country with English subtitles. And there's even a Rotterdam Expat Choir. So check them out. I think Daniel shared some links in the chat. As soon as everything is open again, you get can get in touch with them, but a lot is also online at this moment. Let me see how I can get to the next slide. Yes, so what's still to do at this moment? There are a lot of walking routes in our beautiful city. I think every week there are new ones coming up. For example, we have the Tasty Walks where you can choose off in, I think in the meanwhile, between 20 different Tasty Walks over the bridges, but also in the north or in the south. It's really fun to do. For the sporty ones, there's also the walk by VOD. That's every weekend, whereby you can do a walk through different areas in the city as well, and where you have like stops where you have to do an actually workout. So this also helps you to keep fit and not being all day behind the screen. There are also a lot of nice initiatives, such as, for example, the Floating Farm, which you could visit with your family or also by yourself. They are located in the harbor, and Daniel will also share the link with you. And there's, for example, nice to support also the farmers there. You can get there a glass of milk or your yogurt. How cool is it to get it from the floating farm? For the ones who enjoyed the nice weather the week before, today and tomorrow will rain, but hopefully after that we'll have some nice spring weather again. We'll go to the parks. The parks are really nice in Rotterdam. We have a lot, and they are safe as well. You have the circles, as you can see on the picture, and there you can go with your friends or with your family for a picnic, or even in the most parks in Rotterdam, you're allowed to barbecue there. So it's still, a way to meet others. And last but not least, of course, we are very proud because soon we have Eurovision Song Festival here in Rotterdam. I see Claire already saying, yeah. we're very excited. Of course, it's not the way that it was supposed to be, but still, as you could have seen throughout the city, we have a lot of banners and there are a lot of initiatives also online. Sometimes you hear a concert in a corner. And we at the moment also have the Rotterdam Swing Along campaign. So check it out. We have there is even a dance you can follow, and some nice dance will be picked out and will be actually screened on the Port of Holland or Port of Rotterdam building, as you can see in the picture. So I would say, how nice would it be if we even have some expats dancing on the screen there? The Eurovision will be in the weekend of 22nd of May. And of course it will be on TV. There's it will be a test field lab actually. So visitors will be allowed to go and watch. It's already, the tickets already sold, but there it will be of course very strict on testing, and it will be actually from the Dutch government also track to see how, is it a way how we can have events in the future? As said, the next Expat Cafe will be on May 27th. It will be about housing. I see that Dr. Nguyen is now logging in as well for the workshop. So I'll admit him. But first, that I would like to give the word to Cornelis to tell us a bit more about the Venture Cafe. Because after this session, you can either choose to stay here and follow the health workshop, or you can also already switch to the networking space to get in touch, for example, with Sterling or female venture female ventures, but it's also possible to do after the workshop with Dr. Nguyen. So maybe Cornelis.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Laura, and thanks, Thomas, as well for sharing your story. Very nice to hear. So yeah, I'm from VentureFair Rotterdam. VentureFair is a place where people connect every Thursday evening. We usually do it in Groot Handelsgebouw, which is right next to Rotterdam Central Station. But of course, for the last year, we've been fully online. And a big part of VentureFair is networking. So meeting other people, a lot of expats, a lot of students, a lot of people working at startups, a lot of innovators, as we call them, and growing your network that way. So we're still trying to facilitate that online. So next to these sessions, we also have a virtual networking space. We do that on a platform called Remo. So I'll post a link in the chat for that now. All you have to do is make an account and then you can log in. You see all these little networking tables that are there and you can hop from table to table and talk to different people. There's a max of 6 per table to really encourage networking. And that's also where you'll see the info tables labeled for Female Ventures and the International Women's Networking Group and some tables from VentureFay as well. Just a heads up, at 5:15, we're going to have some pitches from students from the Willem de Koning Academy. So they're doing a project for school, trying to develop business ideas, and they want to pitch it to the innovation community. So it'd be great if you guys came along for that and gave them some feedback afterwards. But that sort of takes over the whole networking space for 15 minutes. So just a heads up so you don't get confused when that does happen. So this is the link for Remo in the chats. And as Laura just said, if you want to stay for the health session, then you stay in this evening.
Thanks, Cornelis. And I see that Thomas just shared the favorite Portuguese cafe, Daily Cakes. And probably you have to taste the pastel de nata, I guess, Thomas.
Yeah. It's actually currently saying that now it's closed, I believe, due to COVID, but I think that information is wrong. But I still haven't been able to check since it opened up, but hoping it's open.
Okay, perfect. Well, I see that Dr. Nguyen is also logged in already now. Welcome, Dr. Nguyen.
Hello, everybody.
So I think for now I'll prepare the presentation, and then we'll actually switch into the health workshop already. So as Cornelis said, for the ones that want to go into the social space already now, they can switch. And the ones that would like to learn more about the Dutch health system, please stay. And it will be also an interactive session. So Dr. Nguyen will give a presentation. And if you have any questions, just put them in the chat or ask them at the end, and I will track it and we'll ask Dr. Nguyen at the end everything. So let me quickly share my screen. Apologies for the background. I'm still at the office today with a lot of expats, so you still hear my colleagues in the background. All right, let me see. Here we go. So the floor is yours, Dr. Nguyen.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Laura. Thank you for the introduction. Hello, everybody. My name is Nguyen, Tao Nguyen. I'm a GP in Rotterdam and working at the International Health Center Rotterdam. And I'm also working at two different practices. It's one big practice is Huis Apotheek Blaak. I'm so the owner of the practice, and in the very near future, in June, I think 1st of July, we will move to another location in the Wijnhaven. It's now on the block, but we'll be on the Wijnhaven. And one of my colleagues will be join me as an associate. And further, I have another practice in Overschiet. So I'm working in different locations. And Laura and Claes has asked me to explain something about the healthcare in the Netherlands. So I think 2 years ago, I also did this presentation about the healthcare in the Netherlands. So I understand that a lot of expats have a different expectation about the healthcare. And Dutch healthcare could be seems very challenging if you not understand how it works. So sometimes, yeah, usually it's a kind of expectation, and what expert expect is not always the same what the GPs or the healthcare in the Netherlands can provide. So let me see. Let me talk about some topic. These are the topic that I want to discuss a bit briefly. How many time do I have, Laura?
Well, you have until 5 o'clock.
5 o'clock. Okay, I will keep it short, and then then you because I see a lot of list of oh wow my god I have to speak a lot so very quick. So I will I've pinpoint some main points, and I think I leave some time left for questions. Maybe it's good.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, I think there's I see only about 14 or 15 participants, so it will not be big crowd. So, okay, let's have the next slide. The Dutch healthcare system. Okay, you see here how the Dutch healthcare system is organized, and most importantly is I think the green part of the healthcare, what is stated here, the primary care. I think 95% of all the healthcare questions have been helped by the primary care.
So to see, heb je geen.
So Siri is one that talk with me. Sorry for that. Because a lot of healthcare issues it's been taken care of in the primary care. So that's not I think it's different for where you come from different countries. So other countries more or less have the secondary line for their healthcare issues. So that's what the difference here in the Netherlands. So that is one of the expectation that experts have when they come over here and said, okay, I want to see a gynecologist, or I want to see a dermatologist, that they directly can go to the secondary line to the hospital to see a specialist. But that's not how it works here. I think that you all maybe know already. So you always have to go to the GP first, the general practitioner. And a lot of things are been done in the primary care. So that is what you have to realize that is different in your country. Really 95%, remember this, 95% of all the healthcare is taking place in the primary care. Yeah, and if there's something you need more tests or have to send to refer to a specialist, then the GP, you need the GP to refer you to the secondary line. And also you have an academic medical center, this Erasmus MC, and that's really for the specialized care, the high care. So you end up there when the secondary line are finished with you, or they cannot treat you anymore, they will send you to Erasmus MC. So don't go there so quickly. next slide. Okay, that I mentioned all the hospital here in Rotterdam in the region. So academically, it's only Erasmus MC. This is for the whole region, and other near center hospital is the most common is the St. Franciscus Gasthuis, where also is located the primary care for GP. It's okay. The next slides are so fine. So if you have emergency care, the GP is usually all GPs in Rotterdam is open from 8 o'clock to 5 o'clock. And after 5 o'clock till the next day, if you have an emergency medical issues, you have to call the huisartsenpost. The number will later on then on this screen, on this presentation, I think. And that is the if you have emergency, then you have to go there during out of office time, even in weekends or holidays, Christmas, New Year's, things like that. You go to the huisartsenpost, and that's also located here in the near center in the San Francisco hospital, there where it is. So the next slide, what you see is that the GP is in the center. No, sorry. Okay, you have the best. Okay, about the GP. Yeah, a GP has a very important role in the Netherlands. It's usually the gatekeeper of the healthcare in the Dutch healthcare system. So every issues that you have to go to the GP first. So the GP can refer you all the hospital or the paramedic, send a prescription to a pharmacist, or done some of the primary care diagnostic lab, x-rays, also obstetric care. The GP can refer you to that, or you can send to the mental health care. And after you've been sent by a GP, the specialists will give a report after they have treated you. They will give a summary or report back to the GP. So the GP is also your medical file, and the GP is your main medical file. It's most important that every medical institution send back to your own GP. So most important thing, if you're in Ireland, most important, have a Dutch insurance to register in the GP. I will further in later on, I will mention that also, because a GP is so important for your medical care. So if you come in Netherlands, first find a GP near your house, your neighborhood. You have to register at a GP. Yeah. Next slide. I know what the next slide is. Oh, okay. That is how the GP practice in Rotterdam. I hear a lot of course, 2 years, 3 years late. There is very difficult. I hear some rumor that it's very difficult to find a GP in Rotterdam, and a lot of practice is closed for new registration, because GP. There is a shortage in GP, not in Rotterdam only, but also in whole Netherlands is there a shortage of GP. So it's a challenge to find a GP and living near to your neighborhood and say, okay, I want to register to your practice. And sometimes they said they are full, they cannot register you anymore. But don't panic, you can call your insurer. If you have that insurance, just call them. They have the obligation to provide you a GP near your house. That is their responsibility. Just know that. If you said, okay, the GP next door, the one who registered me, call your insurance company where you have your insurance, your health insurance. They have to provide you for the basic care for GP. So if the GP now, they have to take you if you live in the neighborhood, yeah? So there are a lot of practice here in Rotterdam, I think, yeah, more than 160, I see. So there are small practices variating from 1 to 10 GPs in one practice. Like my practice on the block, there are 6 or 7 GPs is working. So most GP work 3 days a week or 2 days. Some work 4 days a week. So it depends. And that's why also everyone has to be registered at one practice. Oh, you cannot register in different practice. Eh? You only have to register in one practice. So the job say, okay, I registered this GP and other GP. It's not possible. it's only possible to register in one practice. It's near your neighborhood. Difficulty finding a GP. I indicate that also. Appointment for consultation. Yeah, it's before Corona is different. Now I just told after Corona, and now GPs don't want patients just to come without an appointment to the practice during all the COVID-19 issues and preventive measures. So usually they're going more online. So you can make appointment online for a phone or a video call consultation first. And if the GP think, oh, you really need a physical checkup or follow up, then the GP will invite you for to the practice for a consultation. So that's now how it works nowadays. And usually the consultations takes about 10 or 20 minutes, depending what kind of issues you have. One of the most thing what I see in expat is GPs in Netherlands, in the Netherlands don't like if you come to a GP with a medical issue and you said, okay, I want a referral to a dermatologist, or I want an X-ray, or I want an antibiotic because if I have a fever. Don't do that. GPs in Netherlands are very fast offended if you go there and you ask for the treatment first. Just go there and said, what are your symptoms? Are you sick? Are you ill? Or you have fever? Just put your symptoms or your complaint, your medical issue. Just let it down. Just ask the GP for that, and then let the GP decide what to do. Don't worry. I hear a lot of stories that Dutch GPs only send you away with the paracetamol, and you have to be dying that they're doing something. I don't care. I know that there is on the expat that rumor is going on, but I'm not offended to that. But I hear that a lot, and GPs in the Netherlands. A lot, because a lot of people go to the GP for very small medical issues, and that's why GPs always tend to, is this necessary or this is not necessary? And in the Netherlands, GPs don't prescribe so quickly medications like antibiotics like that. In France or in other countries, you can buy it over the counter, but that's not how GPs in Netherlands work. So they do not only prescribe paracetamol, but if it's really necessary, they will prescribe you medication and will send you to the specialist. So don't worry. Okay. So in practice, there are more staff members that is some big practice all will have all of this, assistant nurses and psychologists. They will have that also in my practice. We all have this. Okay, can you have a next slide? Mental health care. Also the mental health care, you can also go to the GP. For the small issues, you can stay within the GP practice, because if they have a psychologist in the GP, then you can be treated in the practice itself. Because because now during Corona, there's a lot of question first demand a lot of need for mental health care. So the waiting list for also is the general health care is very long nowadays. So if the GP has to send you to a different mental health care institute, the waiting list could be very long. It could be from 3 months to 6 months. So if you have mental issues during these days, it's also a challenge to find proper healthcare. They're still calling me. Sorry for that. Okay, obstetric care. If you're pregnant in the Netherlands, the most obstetric care would provide by midwife and not by a gynecologist. And what most experts used to, that they want to refer to a gynecologist. But in Netherlands, the most pregnancies will be guided by a midwife. So if you're pregnant, mention go to your GP and say that you're pregnant, and the GP will send you to a midwife. And if it's if there's something wrong or something, you have a medical issue, medical history that might be complicate your pregnancy, then the GP will refer you to the gynecologist first. preventive healthcare in the Netherlands. That is, experts also complaining a lot about the preventive healthcare in the Netherlands. And I understand that complaint, because we are in the Netherlands, we're doing not so much about preventive healthcare like other countries. So, if you want to go to a GP and said and ask him for, I want a blood test, a full blood test, and I want an MRI. You will not get it. I can promise you that. Most of the GPs will not do that unless you have some issues, or you have some high risk for cardiovascular diseases of diabetes in the family, that's running in the family, and you said that to the GP, and the GP might run some blood tests. But really preventive healthcare, that you go to the GP and said, I have a checkup, a yearly checkup, usually they do not do that. And I understand that usually young women here, and expats, young women come to Netherlands and they ask, I want to go to a gynecologist for a checkup. And this is very common in their countries, but not in the Netherlands. So the GP will very... they're not so sending you so easy to go to the gynecologist for a checkup, because they said that for cervical cancer and for women there is also like a population screening, but it will start when you age went to the age of 30 and every 5 years and not yearly. If there's something wrong with the pap smear, then you'll be advised to do once a year or once in 6 months, depending how the results from the screening are. And other population screenings like breast cancer is starting from age of 50, and colon cancer even older. And for the youth, there are some, of course, it's preventive healthcare, what we call the consultatiearts, the CJG, this is Centrum for Youth and Family. There are a lot of locations, and that is from the gemeente Rotterdam, and that's for children from 0 to 18 years old. And they will receive invitation to go to check up, like when they have 3 months for all the vaccinations, the healthcare, the vaccination program for the Dutch healthcare vaccination program, you will receive by the CJG. And vaccination and travel service, the GGD is doing that in the Netherlands. And some of the GP practice is doing that, and we here in International Health Center we also doing that, but not that often. And for the flu vaccinations and also the corona vaccinations, I will come at that later on. There was one of requests to say something about the corona vaccination. The vaccinations for the flu vaccinations, if you have an health issue like asthma or diabetic or rheumatic diagnosis in your medical history, you will receive a flu vaccination from your GP. And that's also the corona. I jump to the a little bit to the corona vaccination. The corona vaccination is very done by the GP, by a very small population of the GP. The only people from 60 to 64 will get an invitation from GP to do the corona vaccination, and it's AstraZeneca vaccination that the GPs have. And for you expert, it's very important that you have registered it at the GP practice. If you have medical issues, please register as soon as possible by a GP practice, so that the GP can give you, because the GP has to give all the population that normally receive the flu vaccination to the GGD. And the GGD will invite those patients for vaccination. So the people expert with the medical conditions will be invited by the GP, and the GP will send to the GGD, and you will receive the invitation from the GGD, not from the GP. So the GP is only doing a very small fraction of the vaccination. It's only 60 and 64. Yeah, you can ask me that another time. And paramedics, for paramedics, you don't need a referral. It's not required, but it's preferable, like for the physiotherapists. And you can so just go to the paramedics and say, okay, I want some treatment. That's fine. Next. Can you have the next slide, maybe? Pharmacies is you always a lot of things you need a prescription from your GP or from or dentist also prescribe antibiotics, and usually medical doctors prescribe prescription, and a lot of prescription is needed to when you go to a pharmacy, and some self medication like paracetamol, naproxen, ibuprofen, things like that, and vitamins, you can go buy it in the drugstore. But I will advise you do not go to buy too much painkillers, because I see that the use is a lot, so not recommendable. Next slide. Health insurance. Yes, I'm a doctor and I'm not an insurance company, so I'm not know a lot of these things. But what I know is that you really have like a basic insurance. And in the Netherlands, it's like a principle of solidarity. And you pay insurance fee, insurance, for the insurance company, and you have basic insurance, and everybody receive that. And in the Netherlands, it's common that even the medical care that is provided for a CEO or just a worker on the street is really the same. So there is no extra. If you have an extra status, that you receive more or better healthcare than anybody else. So. That's why it's the GP is really the gatekeeper, and that's not everyone that they send not everyone to the specialist. Otherwise, then the monthly payment for your insurance policy will be very high. Okay, what most important is that you can switch. Oh yeah, the cost, the monthly fee. Yeah, that's true. And the annual access, there is annual access. If you exceed that amount of 385 euro, that's for I think last year. I think this year is also the same on 375. If you the first 385 euros that you have to pay by yourself if you have been sent to the hospital. So if you go to the hospital or to a specialist, or you receive medication, or you do some tests in the laboratory, that first amount will be deductive first before the insurance company will pay you. So this is the amount that everybody in the Netherlands adult patient has to pay every year. Switching to healthcare insurance. Once a year, you can switch to a different insurer. And I think it's in December or in November, in the last month before December, you have to decide, I want to switch insurer, because in between, you cannot switch. That's also weird, but you cannot switch in the beginning. Emergencies, yes, call 112 if it's life-threatening, and urgent medical issues, always call your GP. And outside office hours, you see the house, I suppose, where you live. Usually in the center is the house, I suppose, Rotterdam North. The phone number is there. Maybe your phone number, you can make a picture, or I don't know. If you punch in Huisartsen Post, you're in Google and you will find it. Or your own GP website is also stated the number of the Huisartsen Post that is obligated. And then also in English now. Take home message. Get a Dutch insurance. Yes, find a GP. And life-threatening issues, call 112. Otherwise, go to your GP. So that was very fast. I have 5 minutes, 6 minutes to answer questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nguyen. Yeah, I saw already one question in the chat. I'm still registered with my GP in The Hague because I used to live there. Do I have to change my GP now? Yes. I live in Rotterdam.
Yes, do that, because if you don't do that, then you will have you will be in trouble, because if something is in emergency, the GP in The Hague cannot come over here, but it's his obligation to come at your home within 15 minutes. So the GP has the obligation in case of emergency. That's not life threatening, because if, let's say you hurt your back and you cannot go to your GP and you have a very pain. And the GP, and you cannot go to the doctor's office. So the doctor, the GP has to come to your house. Mm-hmm. And that's not possible if you have lived in here and your GP is in Den Haag. And also, sometime for that also, a GP is organized in a group of GPs in the neighborhood. In the wijk, I don't know, in the wijk, is the neighbor. And if one GP is going on vacation, the other GP will pick up on the emergency. And on the emergency, if the emergency is in out of the area, then the GP that is doing the work with doing the vacation of your own GP, she or she will not go further than the own area. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, I see another one. What is the cost per year for a good insurance?
Oh, this is, I'm not expert in insurance. I think the basic insurance is about 1,100 euro a year, I think like that. And some additional insurance, I really don't know. There's a few hundreds additional to that basic one.
Yeah, I think that
should be fine.
Yeah, I think that it really depends, Roberta, on your needs. I'll share also in the chat a website. It's called Zorgwijzer. It's in English, and it's a comparison website, which might guide you also in pricing. And you have a filter there where you can filter what your needs are, and then you see a comparison in prices. Maybe this helps as well.
Okay.
Maybe a question which we get a lot. I see another one. Can you explain about getting vaccinated by the centers, not the GP? I can't remember what the center are called. GGD, very typical word, Sterling. Will I need to call to make an appointment? Will my GP refer to me somewhere to get a vaccination when I'm eligible?
I think you have to, if you're registered resident in the Netherlands and you're registered in the gemeente, then you are known by the GGD. So the GGD is responsible for the public health and also the vaccination of corona. So if you're registered in the gemeente, then you should be registered at the GGD. And for the GP is only if you have medical issues. It's very important, and then if you have medical issues, then the GP you will have voorrang
priority
to vaccinate it first if you have that, and that's why you have to register as GP and you have a medical issue.
Yeah, and also just shared in the chat the governmental website where you can see if you don't have any, if you're not a healthcare worker, if you don't have any further health issues, you find now a list with your age when you're approximately about to get vaccinated. But I think for now, correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Nguyen, but by June, the goal is that everybody should be vaccinated. So let's say the summer with the first vaccination.
Yes, that's their goal, to have end of June that everybody have the first shot, depending which shot you will receive. And of course, if you're a worker in the healthcare, you will have priority. And if you come working for me, then I can send you. You get Pfizer at GGD, what I heard. But otherwise, you really have to wait for the GGD or for the gemeente to send you an invitation for the GGD for the vaccination.
And maybe another question we get a lot, Dr. Nguyen, I'm not sure if you can give some guidance, but it's especially about testing, of course, for expats going home to their home country, getting back. And I see at your practice, you can also do some tests, right, in order to get again. So what's the difference between then a GGD test, the PCR, or there are, of course, at the moment also a lot of private places where you can get tested with a certificate?
Yes. The GGD is testing PCR or antigen rapid test. They do those two tests. And the difference is that the GGD will not provide you a fit to fly certificate, or they will not give you this is your result. They will send you an email or they call you. I don't know how they do it for patient that your test is positive or negative. So you will not get a certificate that you've been negative tested. And our center, International Health Center, we do this because a lot of experts want to travel back to their countries and they can get that nowhere. The GGD will not provide them for that. That's why we're doing the test at our center. So it's not covered by insurance. So if you test it here, then I take a swab and I send it to the lab. And the lab charged me, the ESCM, because it's not from the public healthcare. So it's really private. So I have some, agreement with the lab that they do this test extra for our expats that is want to travel. So there are costs for that. And I hope that in the near future, it will be free if you, the PCR test, the negative will be free. So they are discussing that now in the EU, also in the Netherlands. So yes, and indeed, answering your question, Laura, you can let it test at our place in the National Health Center. And I also provide you a fit to fly certificate, because a lot of air countries demand that you, if you go to on an airplane, you have to have a fit to fly certificate to boarding. So that's why... If you're on our website, you can apply that for a test, and you also apply for a rapid test. And it's depending on which country you are going, because every country has a different policy that letting you the people in. So if you want to know, just contact our website. Our assistants, native, or you can call EACA when we are open. She knows, she has a website, she can check which country needs what kind of certificate and what kind of tests they need and in how many hours in advance. So that's also important to know when you are going and what our flight are, and that we can check it for you.
Thank you. Well, are there any further questions? Maybe one last question before we can move to the social network space. Well, and otherwise, thank you so much, Dr. Nguyen. It's always good to have. I mean, it's a lot of information, but I think it's really good and important information. So also for the ones who would like to get the PowerPoint or this recording, send us an email to the expert center. I'll just share our email address and we can share it with you, because I think it's really important to have your health in order, especially in those times that we're living in now. And especially on the vaccination, well, a kind remember, if you don't got registered yet with your BSN, it's very important to be registered. Also get registered with your GP, because then you automatically will get a letter to get vaccinated.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you again, Dr. Nguyen, and thank you, Thomas, for being our speakers today.